to the Asia-Pacific region. He leads 80 countries in Asia-Pacific with a strong vision of positivity that actually impacts business communities globally. Could we have a round of applause for Mahesh Mahesh-Srivastava, BNI President, Asia-Pacific.
Seated among many eminent personalities. This is my story. All of us have our own story, and I learned along the way that we are always born. The family that we are born in teaches us the lessons that we need to learn. We take a soul journey coming down to earth, and normally we choose the family that we get born in, because they teach us the lessons that we then inculcate and then go back up and then come back to the next journey. So I do travel quite a bit because I support 18 countries in Asia Pacific now. And so I don't get jet lag, I get more ground lag. If I'm on the ground for more than 2 to 3 days, I want to feel that jet engines, you know. I know exactly when the pilot is like slowing down, I know exactly it's going to take another 25 minutes to land. And it's a thing. But the reason why I travel so much is because I'm very passionate about making a difference in other people's lives. I would like to share a story. A story that a few years ago when I went to Egypt, I was doing some soul searching, and I knew outside of my business activities, there are times when I take off. I take off to discover the inner self. And this was one experience that kind of was a paradigm shift for me, and I thought maybe I can share it with you guys. So years ago, in 2003, I moved back from the US to India. I was setting up a company here. Back office support. I lived in Chicago earlier, but moved back. And I got stuck in an elevator while coming down from the 18th floor. Perfectly fine, but I was alone in the elevator, right, for 20 minutes. So that built in the fear of claustrophobia. Anybody experiences the fear of claustrophobia, or any fear, okay? I never had that type of fear for so many years, but that kind of triggered that in me. So I went through some treatment, there's NLP techniques and other ways to get out of the claustrophobia. So there were times when I had the claustrophobia, when I had to go to a BNI meeting, I would not take the elevator, I will walk two floors. And I will just kid with my associates saying, look, I need to exercise, you guys, you take the elevator, I'll join you. But the real thing was I was afraid of getting into that elevator, right? So once I got my NLP done and got that, you know, fear out, so everything was perfectly fine. So a few years later, I went to Egypt, and in Egypt, I had gone with a bunch of people who were all soul searching, and I was part of that thing. The goal was, you go into Egypt, you go into Giza pyramids. Anybody has been to the Giza pyramids? Yeah? And when you enter the Giza pyramid, it's a small square entrance, and you'll actually have to bend down, because it's only like a 4 feet, 4.5 feet. So all my friends went, the moment I saw the entrance to it, and I looked down, and that's what I saw. I saw pitch black darkness. And that's, it triggered again. My claustrophobia triggered again. And I was so fearful to enter that Giza pyramid. After investing so much money, and going on my soul journey, and trying to discover various things, I couldn't walk in. I just could not walk in. I was standing there looking at it, and the fear kicked in, and I'm not sure if you guys have experienced extreme fear, it immediately pushed me back. And I went back, because fear is a good thing. Fear is a good thing because it is a survival mechanism, it is built into us. And I learned from Tony Robbins that we need to start playing with the fear, we need to channelize fear in a way that it's going to enable to help us. So, long story short, I came back, I was standing at the back over here, and that's when, that tour guide who took us and said, why are you not going down? He said, there's too many steps. I can't see. He said, no, there are only 50 steps you can go down. I was still not convinced. I was standing there. Then, what happened? Because I'm looking at the darkness. Then there's a huge guy, Arab gentleman, wearing a dark dress. He was one of the security guards. He was looking at me from the side. He came, and as I was standing in the entrance, he held my shoulders. He turned me around. And he pushed me, he said, walk backward. And I was holding that thing and walking backward. Do you see the perception shift? From fear, he changed my perception to see light. And as I was walking backwards, 30 feet, 40 feet, it didn't matter, 80 steps down, I didn't know anything different because I was just following the light. So what the story, why I share this is, all of us need a particular mentor in life. That one shift makes that fear go away. And that's where when we do things over here, like helping children get that one dream, that one shift, I thank that man. I don't know his name, but I do have a photograph of him, because guess what? When I went down, all was fine. And then there's a long tunnel. My friends had already crossed through the tunnel and they had already gone up to the King's Chamber. So the King's Chamber is a few feet away and we need to go back in. And the goal of this whole journey was, we go through that and I actually slept in that cavity which was once at home. Okay, a few of us had a chance to do that, not all of us. But the thing is that if I had not done that, if I just succumbed to my fears, because I did not know otherwise, if I didn't have that mentor to switch my perspective, I would have lost. Even today, I would have regretted, hey, I spent so much money, I went all the way, I went on a soul journey. That was my goal, but I did not achieve that goal because I did not have a proper mentor. So this led me to think that, okay, all of us as entrepreneurs, as people, we need that one guide. Okay, education is that one guide, or to be a friend. The mentor can come from any perspective. It doesn't have to be something older than you. It can come from something younger than you. It can come from your peer. It can come from your sibling. Right. So now let's talk about my past. I grew up in a fairly well-to-do family. My dad was a business owner, and we had an automobile spares business. And he was a rags-to-riches story. His business he learned here in Mumbai, and that's the reason why Mumbai is very close to my heart. My dad, being a typical Bram family, you know, his siblings, he had 16, he's the eldest of 16 children. You know, 16 children, no social media those days, no TV those days. My grandfather had no business, but he had to create his own soap opera, I guess. So he had 16 children. My dad was the eldest of them, and he had to cycle several miles to earn that few annas a day from the Britishers. But when his sister got married and her husband was from Bombay, he came to Bombay and learned the trade of selling automobile spares. He came back, and then he was able to set up a business over the years that educated all his younger brothers, got his sisters married. So I respect him a lot. When I grew up as a kid, we had a few cars. In those days, having cars, it's a big thing, it's a big luxury, because you had to pay the full money, you cannot buy it on EMI. Our first Uptron TV, I remember my dad brought a black and white Uptron TV. Any of you remember that? I know I'm dating myself really back, but you know, that TV was an amazing thing, because you had to pay money, and we had to be a few households that we had that in those days. Okay, so I respect my dad a lot for what he did for the family and how he took us out almost from completely rags to brought us to a level of stabilization. All my cousins today live in the US, they work in the US, but it had to take that one person to take the risk, that fear, breaking the fear and coming out and doing something different, right? And what happened was, when my mom became sick with cancer, my mom died when I was young in school, but at that point my dad got into, he was a social drinker, but he hit the bottle hard. And I'm not sure if many of you have experienced being around an alcoholic family, but I feel that an alcoholic family sometimes destroys many people around you. If you smoke, you kill yourself, but if you get into alcohol, you actually completely have a huge ripple effect around you, right? So the business, all our business, we lost a lot of money. So when it was time for me to go to the US to study, I had no money at all. So how did I earn money when I was in engineering? I used to go and do PCB designs. I used to do all kinds of, I used to hustle and do all kinds of things to save a little bit of money, go to the US. But my US dream didn't come. I was growing up in an alcoholic family. My brothers were also drinking. But there was one mentor in my life. My sister, whose photograph is there next to me, she told me, Matt, you don't have to go the same route as your dad did, or your brothers did. You can be different. Why don't you have the dream of going abroad? I said, how can it? I don't even have, you saw our families. No, you can do it. So she kept on instilling in me, just like that guide shifted my thing. She kept on instilling in me that, oh, you can do it, you can do it. When I went to the US, I only had half a semester's fees and a lot of fees. I do not know how I'm going to survive the second half of the semester. In those days, these were the days when the $1 was 17 rupees. Okay. So, in those days, you need to show a bank balance. So I had to pull money from all my relatives, put it in the bank for one day, get the banker certificate, send it to the college, and get the admission. But the moment I got the admission, the money is vanished from the bank account, right? And only half the semester's fees. So when I went there, I did all kinds of jobs because you have to survive. I did not have money to buy a comforter. The comforters had warm blanket. And I was at one in Indiana State, and in the winters it was cold. I worked in Pizza Hut, I cleaned dishes. My work was done at 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. in the morning, and I had to walk about 20 minutes back to the housing colony where I lived. Many nights was broken, very broken. Some nights, a colleague of mine would give me a ride back home. That's what I call the survival mode. And I'm so thankful that we went through that, because it gave me a sense of appreciation of people who have nothing. Right, if you move from a survival stage, if you are a first-time entrepreneur here, how many of you have started your business, you're the starting entrepreneur, right? Do you remember the many months where the month is much longer than the money you have? Your rents are coming up, your salaries are coming up, and you don't know how to pay it. So that's where you go on faith. I remember praying a lot. And even now, in India, after I came back, I started 2-3 businesses. Many times I had to go to the bank manager, sir, please give me a line of credit. Here are my clients. My clients have not paid me yet, but I still need to meet my salaries. There were times when I used to pray to God, God, please help me this month to pay my vendors and my employees. That's all I'm asking you. Because if I can pay them both, my business will survive. Okay, that's survival mode. But over a period of time, you get into the stability mode. Stability mode is when everything that you have, you already... It's magic. You start saving some money, you get, but that mode sometimes can be the most dangerous mode. Because you get very comfortable. You don't need to do anything more. You're quite comfortable. Many of us here in this audience are in that stability mode or more. But in my BNI environment, I come back, I wake them up. I say, hey guys. I know many of you have crossed through the survival mode and come to the stability mode, but we have a responsibility. We took this journey down to earth for a particular reason. I want you to get into the stage of abundance. Abundance is when you're earning much more money, having everything that you need. Wouldn't that be fantastic? Yeah, and when we're able to deploy that money into things like our Women Foundation Trust. Right? We need to make a difference before we leave. We have to. It is our responsibility to leave behind a legacy. If you're a business owner here, we have to leave behind a legacy. There is only a certain amount of money in the world today. There's a finite amount of money. If you take out everything from your pockets, take out everything from the banks, do you agree there's a finite amount of money? Now that money is going to channelize, it is going to come down, right? It either flows through your pockets or it's going to flow through the people who are in the negative world, like the drugs and the arms and the other things that are negative on earth. So it is our responsibility, whatever we do, it is our responsibility to channelize that wealth into our hands and deploy it in things that are of good, that you leave behind a legacy. And the legacy can be such that they don't even need to know you were instrumental in it. Right? So that's why I was saying that you go from survival to stability and abundance. So that's where I'm talking about. You get into the stage of abundance where you don't have to worry about money anymore. It happens. And have faith, because God, there's enough in this universe to provide for all of us. You just have to step out on faith. When I walked into the US, I really stepped out on faith. Have you seen that Indiana Jones movie, where Raiders of the Lost Ark, where he actually steps out of the ledge, and then the invisible bridge happens? Many of times in my life, even day to day, when I go around the world talking to entrepreneurs, many instances I don't even know what I'm doing, where I'm doing, but you always step on it, because he, or whatever you believe in, the universal sources that will help you. So a few lessons that I learned along the way, there are about 6 or 7 points. I'm not going to go too deep in them, but work on yourself. These are some of the things that I did for myself. I was an IT guy, a geek, right? A robotics engineer. But I was told by my mentors, I need to work on myself as a person. if you fix the man or woman within, the world around you falls into place. So that's what I did. And as I did more and more of that, I was given more responsibilities in management. And they took me out of it. Today, I was talking to another gentleman here who was in the cloud computing. I was the Microsoft practice manager at one point, but today, I do not know anything about Microsoft or all of it. It's more people management. We have, in today's world, to survive, we have to be very agile. Gone are the rigid mindsets. We have to be agile. It's a mobile app world. It's a lot of things are happening. A lot of things are happening. A shift is happening. And the shift is happening here in the APAC region, right? And we have to be agile for our business, agile to our families, and I think, and develop a sense of lifelong learning. We have to, because nobody is fully learned. We are learning here amongst ourselves. We need to be attending events like this, like Esperance. For me, events that changed my perspectives were when I attended, you know, like the Tony Robbins. He's got an event called the Unleash the Power Within. It's a four-day event, but he teaches you how to control fear, how to use fear. On the end of the first day, I was able to walk on a long stretch of coal. I had never walked on fire before. Amazing, amazing stuff, but we have to invest in ourselves, in our brains first, because only then we can make an impact in the lives of others. We have to develop people's skills. I already talked to you about some of the techniques that I learned. I'm listing a couple of books here. Was how to win friends and influence people. The five love languages. Dale Carnegie. The five love languages taught me a lot. It taught me even not only it's not about husband and wife relationships, it also taught me how I need with my children. Some of us like gifts, some of us like the language of saying, hey, I love you. Some of us like work done for us. Some of us like touch. Some of us, you know, like the time. So there are five love languages and you find out. So these are immensely powerful books. Another thing that I learned is develop your financial skills. No point in becoming a fantastic person inside if you do not know how to control money. We have to. It is our responsibility to learn how to make money and how to channelize it. So develop that. And then develop spiritual skills. You may be wondering, why is Max on stage talking about spirituality? Spiritual skills can come in any way. One is, you can talk, you may think spiritual is religious, but to me, spiritual skills is connecting to your own higher self. We all come from a source. And the more we connect to our higher self, life starts opening like magic. How do I say connect to your higher self is start working on your own gut. Trust your own gut. A couple of books that helped me in that area is Your Psychic Pathway by Sonia Choquette. Okay, she teaches you, start playing with your own gut feeling. Being a psychic doesn't mean, I can understand, you know, I can predict your future. No. It's day in and day out you're making decisions. You need to start learning how to trust your psychic and how to trust your own gut. One of the techniques she taught me, I'm in the book, an audiobook, she said, and I will share that with you, you can start playing with it. It's called the technique of I wonder. Go play with it. Because what do I mean by go play with a sentence? Start any sentence with I wonder. Okay? Because that I wonder statement connects with your higher self. And then you get the answer. And then you start playing with it. I'll give you an example when I started this exercise. I travel every day. I'm here at the hotel. I may say that I press the elevator button and I just think, okay, I wonder which elevator is going to come down first. Even this morning when I came to the airport, I wondered. And when you start saying that I wonder exercise, it will start giving you, you start learning how to do your instinct. You have to start learning how to use your instinct. Because then, when it comes to business decisions, it automatically you know, hey, that's my gut feeling, that's what I'm going to go. Develop a sense of gratitude, because without gratitude, there's nothing in this earth. Gratitude is primary. What technique did I learn in gratitude? From Tony Robbins' tapes. He tells when you go for your morning walk, spend 5 minutes, start with your inner circle. I thank my wife, I thank my children, I thank my in-laws for being there with me. And then start with your, you know, the servants that may serve you every day. Start with your friends. Thank your business partners. Thank the client that you're going to meet today. Because when you start thanking, the universe will start giving more of what you like. Gratitude is a very important cycle that most of us forget to give back. So gratitude is the thing. And finally, many of us say, hey, Mac, they always say, do your passion, do your purpose, find your purpose. Today I know my purpose in life. It doesn't matter whether it's BNI, whether it's a scar, whether what it is, I know my purpose. And I know that things in the universe is align itself to my purpose because I know my purpose. I didn't get there when I was a student. I didn't get there when I was a computer geek. I didn't get there in the early stages of my career. How do you find your purpose? Start listing your passions. Start listing, write down 4 or 5 of your passions and start doing more of your passions. And from your passions will come out the purpose. It is your own soul discovery that will happen. It will happen like magic. You may not even know when it comes up, but unless you list down what is your passion, they'll say you need to be an engineer or whatever. No, follow your passions. And then finally, it's your journey, it's your life, right? So we are here, you need to have fun with it. We are all here on a journey, we have taken this thing. Don't put too much hassle. Whatever problems you're getting now, or issues, you say, hey, in 5 years' time, will this matter? If there's a political issue between you and your sister or your brother, in 5 years' time, will it matter? In 10 years' time, will it matter? It'll go up. It's okay. Let us not fret too much about it. Let's have fun along this journey. With that, a journey is of 1,000 miles, begins with 1 step. I have miles to go before I sleep. And here are some quotes which I have in my house in Florida. You can read through it. And I hand it back to our wonderful MC. Thank you very much for inviting me here today. I really enjoyed this evening.